Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, a picture ebook. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will meet more survivors of the Asian tsunami and read their first-person narrative of a chilling near-death experience and from so many locales. Today I will read out part 1 of chapter 10, and that includes heroes of the tsunami. Tonight we will meet some amazing people who will move your heart infinitum, believe me. But let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading session before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal health care access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the development agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting disaster preparedness or the lack of it at district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Shakespeare said, "Calamities bring out the best or the worst in human nature." Indeed, this behavior of human nature stems from reactions or responses to the nature of challenges or the calamities they face. People who face loss of lives or family members feel benumbed by emotional pain, obviously. Seen impassively, why me? What have I done to deserve this? Are the questions that become irrelevant in a natural calamity where humanity itself is pummeled by the calamity. It possibly takes tremendous energy and positive spirit to look beyond one's misery and then respond to the situation to overcome. But the persons affected cannot see it in a wider context. They are subjected to the calamity and its consequences. So it's not easy for them to overcome. Inevitably, we also encounter the more inglorious elements. But for whom, pardon the cynicism, life would hardly be as diverse as it is. Except that in calamitous situations like the Asian tsunami, it leaves a very bitter taste if you meet, you know, negative characters. It leaves a very bitter taste. I have met many such people, so I will start with this chapter with the more colorful elements and end with a salutation to the heroes who overcame and lived to tell the tale heroically. Take for instance, one upstart in Bangalore who called me the day after the Asian tsunami and gleefully told me, "Malini, not one Malayali," that means people from the Indian state of Kerala, "not one Malayali died in the tsunami, Malini." She said, I was dumbstruck. According to her, Malayalis were spared the terror of the waves because mass in the Malayalam language was going on inside the Velangani church when the tsunami struck. So she said all the Malayalis were safe, but that was a coincidence. This reeked of, you know, parochialism, patriarchy, fratricidal pettiness. I couldn't find more words for such distraught behavior. What else can I say? To be honest, I was dumbfounded, not knowing how to react to this perversion. I meekly said, "Is it?" But it left such a sour note in my mouth that the restiveness of the previous day's calamity revisited me again in spine-chilling distaste. It was after this conversation that I realized that it takes education and exposure, wider experience, modeled courage, culture, strength to overcome, and evolved life skills are the prerequisites for a dispassionate yet sensitive worldview. In another such incident in Gala in Sri Lanka, two men pretended to save a woman who was swirling in the tsunami waters. One of them actually pulled out her gold ornaments and let her be washed away. The incident was filmed by a journalist, and based on this visual evidence, murder charges were arraigned against the gold snatcher. In 2006, he was awarded the death penalty in Sri Lanka. By all accounts, he was not executed. But for me to investigate this with official documentation in a police state like Sri Lanka was simply not possible. Some come in the form of grave administrators who took visionary decisions. Some others volunteered. Others alerted people to the imminent catastrophe moments before the tsunami struck. Still others overcame the trauma with the sheer courage of conviction, exemplifying the milk of human kindness in the human breast. Some others bore the pain, both physical and emotional, with a graceful smile. Here are a few people whose deeds and actions made the difference between life and death, or near death and misery. I am happy to share the pleasure of meeting them with you, my dear readers and viewers. There were others who were caring for the frail and infirm even during rescue. The Bishop of the Church of Mother Mary at Velangini, 11 kilometers north of Nagapattinam, committed to sending food packets to survivors as well as to dispatch volunteers at the disposal of the district administration for relief effort. Such deeds are rare. Like the Bard said, calamities do really bring out the best and the worst in human nature. There were other survivors who were caring for the frail and the infirm even during rescue. Many volunteers, pilgrims who survived the tsunami, were graciously volunteering to carry the dead bodies for storage in hospitals. Volunteers were trying to carry cadavers on two-wheelers. Such was the desperate situation in Nagapattinam. Even injured and bleeding survivors carried dead bodies to the mortuary. The Bard was so prescient in his crisp observation of human nature. Other volunteers were helping search the missing or identify the dead. Still others helped in funeral rituals like mass burials. The volunteers who lent their hand to mass mortality management were the silent heroes who need to be saluted. Future generations in the affected countries and the family members of the deceased ought to be very grateful to these silent heroes. There were other elements in Nagapattinam itself. Fishers were heard saying, "We had not been able to get rid of the baggage that was our mother-in-law. Thank God the sea finally took her." Another fisherman said, "Oh, finally I got rid of this woman." There were others who were happy to have gotten rid of nags that they deemed their relatives to be. Others realized the big compensation money to buy luxury goods like flat screen television sets, refrigerators, things that an impoverished mind can well justify. One fisherman who died in the tsunami in Campbell Bay, Great Nicobar Island in India's Andaman Nicobar Islands, left his mistress from neighboring Sumatra destitute. Since she was not officially married, she could not claim compensation for the death of her partner. In bureaucratic parlance, in India, she was a foreigner. And secondly, she was not officially married. I got in touch with the communications officer of the UNISDR to inquire what would be the best practice in a situation like this. But no response was forthcoming, so I could not quote anything. Such situations do confront administrations with unknown challenges of a humanitarian nature. That is when the humanitarian situation exacerbates the need for a human touch. Perhaps the best practice that can be evolved by learning from such situations is to refer to a database that highlights assets, liabilities, consumption patterns, human development index, socioeconomic status, inventory of government services availed, and legal history or profile of every citizen. In this regard, India's attempt at creating an online enumeration, which is called the Unique Identification Authority of India, or the Aadhaar, is a valiant attempt at creating an online database. Such a database would help prepare an inventory of assets, liabilities, consumption patterns, standard of living, human development index, biometric data, eligibility ratios, tax slabs, etc. Officers who worked in relief and rehabilitation in Nagapattinam vouched for the critical significance of inventorization of assets, liabilities, incomes, expenditure, consumption patterns, and human development index, as well as social indicators like water and sanitation, so that expeditious relief and compensation can be facilitated. This was possible in Tamil Nadu because of transparent governance and a very good administration that prevails in the state. G.S. Bedi, Indian Administrative Service Officer, then District Collector of Cuddalore District, was heroism personified because of his administrative acumen and courage. The Irulas of Tamil Nadu, our indigenous people with their traditional livelihood being hunting snakes and gathering rats. They lived in a marginalized lifestyle exploited by agriculturists for labor. Neither were they able to sustain themselves hunting snakes and eating rats. Nagamuttu, a young Irula tribal in Pichavaram, says so. The coastal dwelling Irulas were engaged in agricultural labor and were earning their bread and butter as bonded laborers with daily wages. With large-scale illiteracy prevailing among them and suffering from exploitation, they had neither negotiating skills nor the requisite awareness for seeking compensation for loss of livelihoods on account of loss of coastal agricultural land after the tsunami. In the aftermath of the tsunami, collector G.S. Bedi included the Irulas in the scheduled tribe list of the constitution. Pitcher Khanna, 55 years old at MGR Nagar, says, and I quote him, "After anthropological studies were conducted, it was established that they were indeed of Irula tribal origin, and it helped in including us in the ST list. These Irula villagers have been engaged by MSSRF, that is the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, in sustainable traditional fisheries, which was a whole new vocation for them. They were given World Bank training by the MSSRF in fishing and livelihood, as a livelihood. We have also taken up mangrove plantation, madam. It has helped in reducing soil salinity, has increased fish catch, and since it was taken up in a conservation-friendly fishbone pattern, it's brought the creeks closer home. For example, it has reduced our fishing labor and fuel costs and helps in sustainable fisheries-based livelihood," says Nagamuttu. After this success story, the Irula tribes, who were earlier hunter-gatherers, have successfully transformed to fisherfolk, sustaining themselves with a monetarily rewarding lifestyle. Today, they are expert fishers, according to MSSRF's marine biologist, Dr. Shiv Kumar. Now, about 270 children are attending schools and there is a dire need for high school for the younger generation of fishers' children. MSSRF, that is the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, interventions taught the Irula tribes how to plant mangroves in a fishbone pattern. That has decreased soil salinity, prevented degradation of mangroves, improved fish yield in the mangrove creeks. It has helped in increasing the numbers, length, and the network of mangrove creeks, in effect bringing the creeks closer to the homes of the Irulas who live in the mangrove forest. With the creeks coming closer home, so has the fish catch. That has decreased fishing labor and fishing hours, increasing fish catch and decreasing fuel costs. It has also meant livelihood and food security. The Irulas have learned skills like crab fattening and crab trapping, oyster harvesting, increased fish yield and income, and thus their standard of living has increased. Before the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation's intervention, they fished with hand picking. Though it was sustainable and not eco-detrimental, the yield has not been sustainable economically, they felt. After the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation's intervention, they created mangrove plantations, and with the increase in fishing catch and incomes, thus livelihoods, the villagers have created a community fund comprising of 30% of every family's monthly income, with which they have now constructed a village temple, school and drinking water facilities for all fisher folk villages. After the tsunami devastation, every fishing family got boats, oars, engines, nets, etc. Apart from fishing boats, we now have gear, hooks, traps, etc. The security in fishing livelihoods has spared us the food insecurity we faced as hunter-gatherers, says Pichakanna. With the community fund, we have also established an early warning helpline. It includes voice SMS intimation to illiterate fisher folk about wave height, currents course, wind direction, fish catch and yield, weather forecast for every 6 hours, and government schemes. There is also a voice SMS broadcast aimed at fisher women about health and hygiene, maternity benefits, menstrual hygiene, and early warning during cyclones. For a more detailed perspective, feel free to read an article by me published in the Interpress service, the link of which has been put up in the description box below. It took just one administrative decision in the aftermath of a debilitating calamity for collector G.S. Bedi to institutionalize pecuniary benefits to a whole community deprived of rights and dignity for centuries, an unlikely circumstance that could catapult an honest civil servant to heroism. But it did, nevertheless. Today, the younger generation of Irulas are grateful for his administrative inclusion of a vulnerable community in the disaster resilience or the development agenda. Nagamuttu, 40 years old, says, If they had not been included in the ST list, they would never have developed or benefited from the government schemes. It all happened thanks to the initiative of IAS officer G.S. Bedi, he swears. We would have remained hunter-gatherers eating rats and hunting snakes. We have benefited from the government schemes like the Forest Rights Act. We developed mangrove plantation on forest land granted to us, and the Forest Rights Act has also given us fishing rights in a protected area like the Pichavaram mangroves. So we now protect the mangroves in lieu of fishing rights. Another encouraging fallout is the awareness about alcoholism. Before we were included in government beneficiary schemes, almost all the fishing income was spent on alcohol. Now we hardly find anyone an alcoholic. All the development has been channelized through the development fund under the guidance of the Village Knowledge Center established by the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation. This government of Tamil Nadu intervention of including the Irulas in the ST, that is the Scheduled Tribes list, by one far-sighted administrator became a successful and multi-layered heroic act of collective leadership, succeeding for the general will, the general good of society that Voltaire referred to 200 years ago. On the other end of the spectrum, lack of mental health solutions has led to a large-scale psychosomatic disorders like hypertension in indigenous people of Nicobar Islands in India, heretofore an unknown disease to rural denizens, much less indigenous people. There are others who may be personally unaffected by the calamity but reach out to help humanity. Others assume responsibilities even if none hands out or assigns responsibilities. It brings out their leadership qualities. Yet, rising to the occasion is not only challenging but is the most courageous thing to do. Such are the people who succeed in life. Yet others see calamities as opportunities to overcome their weak points or the very tragedy itself brought on by the calamity. There are heroes who rededicate themselves to humanity. To be able to smile courageously and seeking comfort in others' happiness is surely heroism personified. I am not philosophizing here, but these were my thoughts after meeting some of the most inspiring of all tsunami survivors. The tsunami did uncover human nature. The human need for love and to be loved as well showed up in the stories of survivors I met during my research. Fishermen of Nagapattinam accused Mr. Parameshwaran and his wife Chudamani, who we have learned in chapter 9, Survivor's Tales, a picture story. The couple had lost all their three children to the tsunami and were accused of killing their children. Can you imagine? Some people in the affected villages accused us of killing our three children and seven relatives, says Mrs. Chudamani Parameshwaran, a tad bit cynical yet very tearful, obviously. This was only because Parameshwaran and his wife were in so much grief after losing all their three children so cruelly on Parameshwaran's 40th birthday to the tsunami. They wanted to drown their sorrow by sharing their misery with others. While visiting affected fisherfolk villages, they found to their shock that their silence was being misinterpreted and mistaken for some bizarre guilt in the perception of desperate survivors. The couple found it healing and purposeful to be able to offer the orphaned children safety, food, clothing, care and shelter. Though they were still hurting themselves, their newfound purpose ameliorated their misery and pain to a slight extent. They opened their home to the orphans of the tsunami, says Parameshwaran. By opening my house to the orphans of the tsunami, not only did it try to fulfill the voids for our quest for love, but brought some peace. In the name of my three deceased children, we gave a home to thousands of other children in the last decade. While I met Mr. Parameshwaran and his wife, I must admit to my readers and viewers, very honestly here, I started crying on hearing their story. I was so moved and became so emotional and upset that I closed my notebook. I just could not write down. I couldn't concentrate or focus. I was simply so moved by the story that I started crying. The pictures I took of Mr. Parameshwaran shook me up. I was sobbing so much. I'm so sorry. I just could not hold my tears. Theirs is truly a very, very touching story. Closing all pretensions to detachment and professionalism, I stopped taking notes. I frankly could not. At that moment, I decided to finish my interview later when I was a little more composed, hopefully. I took his contact details and promised to conduct a Skype interview, and I did. Only after 7 weeks, after finishing my research in Andaman Nicobar Islands, and I came back to mainland and back to Bangalore, after that I conducted a Skype interview. I have on earlier occasions too been overwhelmed by emotion and surrendered to the lump in my throat while conducting, for example, an interview of a HIV-positive pregnant woman. It is the one gift of Mother Nature I have retained to be able to share with my readers with honesty and the emotion I feel as a writer. Meet Parameshwaran and Chudamani, a couple whose contentment and success in life was robbed by destiny. 26th December 2004 was Parameshwaran's 40th birthday, and early that morning, he was happy to be hugged by his three children who wished him happy birthday. A couple of hours thereafter, the biggest disaster in humanity's recorded history claimed the lives of all of his three children and seven of his relatives. They were all washed away by the tsunami on his birthday. The tsunami killed his happiness and contentment in life. He says now he dreads his birthday. Parameshwaran says, I often tell people that if we could recover from our trauma, then anybody is capable of overcoming whatever problems life throws at them. But at night, Parameshwaran still often stands on the balcony overlooking the sea and calls out his children's names softly. This beach was once a paradise for us, then it became a hell, but we will never move away from here. When I look at the waves, I feel closer to my children. The gentleman can never again smile on his birthday. Not that it is ever possible to overcome the death of one's children, birthday or not. With his wife's relatives visiting, they all decided to head to the beach, barely a kilometer from their house, to play baseball and frisbee at the start of their Christmas holidays. Only Chudamani, her mother-in-law, pregnant sister-in-law and her mother stayed back at home. The tsunami was very hard in Nagapattinam. Parameshwaran recalls that his son clung to his hands desperately while he was crying in terror. But the water was simply all too powerful and washed his son away from his desperate hands. Parameshwaran too was washed away, but he was destined to survive. After the waves subsided, Parameshwaran started searching for his children and relatives, and hours later he was destined to carry home the cadavers of his three children. The visiting relatives of his wife too were washed away. I admit to you, my dear reader, I did not muster the courage to ask if he searched for or if he found the bodies of his relatives, so I do not know. A devastated Parameshwaran tried his best to cope with the tragedy that had befallen him and his wife. Inconsolable, Parameshwaran, suffering from incomparable survivor's guilt, wanted to commit suicide by the Wednesday after the tsunami. If their fate was tied to the death of the children in the natural calamity, Parameshwaran felt he could justify his decision to commit suicide. He made a suicide pact with his wife, but his wife responded to an intuitive call of her heart to serve with love and refused to be part of a suicide pact. She gave him the courage and the strength he so badly needed. One cannot even imagine the stress the couple has undergone. After the Asian tsunami, many couples in Tamil Nadu who lost their children rued the fact that they had undergone birth control procedures. A natural calamity makes no exception, unfortunately. Though Catholic priests did try to comfort the hurting couple, Parameshwaran and Chudamani were devastated, and Parameshwaran desperately tried to reach out to seek love. There seemed to be only so much tears left in him. Exhaustion and despair gave way to hope and purpose. After the epiphany that the couple realized on the Thursday, 30th December 2004, that we have already read about in Chapter 9, the Parameshwarans mustered all possible spiritual strength to go out to the world to seek and share their suffering. The epiphany that hit his heart awakened him to the love the world needs and that the whole world is one family after all. Parameshwaran went to the district administration and found ways to volunteer in the aftermath of the calamity. It speaks volumes for his courage that he sought to engage his mind and soul more constructively in service of humanity. We're so proud of him. Though the coastal district of Nagapattinam is very vulnerable to hydrometeorological calamities and disasters like cyclones, sea surge, storms from the Bay of Bengal, and was barely recovering from the cyclone of October 2004, the tsunami was still an unmitigated, unparalleled disaster. Within a couple of hours, the city was pounded so hard by the tsunami that 6,065 human souls perished and the streets were littered with cadavers. About 4,000 of the deceased were women and children, more vulnerable in any disaster. Sharing the heartburn felt by Mr. Parameshwaran and his wife Chudamani can be best done justice to in Mr. Parameshwaran's own words. My wife was in shock and could not speak to anyone for 3 days. She was crying silently. She could not speak to anyone. What do I do? I managed to eat some biscuits and drink water, but my wife did not eat anything, nor did she drink water for 3 days. The third night, I asked my wife if I could bring home some poison because I cannot wake up to see another day. My conscience was pricking me that I must have sinned, for which God must have punished me like this. My wife told me, "Give me one more day. I am fighting with God to get answers." On the fourth day, I was sitting in the children's room looking at the photographs of my children and crying. That day morning, my wife said, "Why are you still crying?" She said she dreamt or heard the Lord's voice, which said, "When thousands of people have died, but my husband is saved, of the 11 people who went from our house to the beach that day, only my husband has been saved. The Lord asked me, doesn't it show a purpose?" That day, she asked me to join her in prayer. I was in no mood, but I joined her. She read the scripture. Finally, she said, "Christ in you is the hope of glory." And she told me that God is speaking to us. Let us pray. When she prayed, she felt hungry. She wanted to eat food, so I ran down and brought some water. My wife asked for some food, but she was feeling hungry. There was no food at home, no restaurant, but only a relief camp. They were throwing food packets from the truck. I picked up 4 food packets. My wife wanted to move around and see what hell had brought to the city, as she was unaware of what had happened. We went to a nearby fishing village, Samandanpet. As soon as we reached there, all the villagers surrounded us, shouting at us, "All these days you were trying to help us for small things. When the real calamity came, you were not here. Why were you not in town? You are coming only on the fourth day." My wife told me, "They do not know what has befallen us, but please do not tell them about anything about us." The Parameshwarans brought home 4 children that day, and that evening he decided to open his house doors to the orphans of the tsunami in honor of his own diseased children. About 60 children in the fishing village had lost both parents or one parent. Among those children, my wife said, "I could see my children in this group." She asked me, "Can we pick up 1 or 2 kids to take home? At least a few kids who resemble our children," she begged. "First time I came out of the house without my children, I want to take back a few children," she said. The village sent 4 kids along with us. On the fourth day after the tsunami, we brought home 4 orphans and opened our heart to fill in the void by providing care and love to the orphans of the tsunami. That was the genesis of the orphanage Nambikai, which we run now. 4 years after the tsunami, I was blessed with 2 more sons by the Lord. We brought home 4 kids 4 days after the tsunami. I decided to open my house to the orphan children of the tsunami. Now 38 kids are living in my house. Within 45 days, my wife and I decided that the best way of honoring my deceased children is to dedicate this property to the orphan children of the tsunami. Tsunami kids should play around our house like if they were our own kids. We both came to terms with the loss of our children by trying to honor our children to help the orphaned kids. We could see our children every day in the orphaned children's play. What a nice thing to say. Many people were struggling because we had suffered so much and had overcome the distraught situation. We thought we should counsel others, so we were involved in counseling at the tsunami relief camps, guiding them to NGO coordination center, traveling with the district administration, going from village to village. People were crying and shouting for having lost kith and kin. The administration faced the first challenge. Thousands were affected. Survivors were facing loss of food, home, and family members. Around the world, people were willing to help but were clueless about whom to help and how to coordinate. Organized the transport, roads were damaged. It was a challenge to the government. District collector was a very good man. He coordinated very well, meeting the challenges from both sides, so he made quick organizational efforts to solve the people's problems. My wife and I shared with them our true story and counseled them. People were feeling encouraged to stop cribbing and they felt motivated after listening to us. We found people were overcoming the trauma, so we committed to visiting villages for counseling. District collector Dr. J. Radhakrishnan and his wife were amazed that this couple, which had suffered so much, had recovered so quickly and is helping us. They used us as an example to share our story so that traumatized people can overcome. We visited almost all the south coastal areas. The district administration recognized us and as good counselors and people to emulate. They chose us to meet former President, US President Bill Clinton, who visited the tsunami affected areas. When I narrated my story to Mr. Clinton, he appreciated that he met such a courageous man in the world. "I will never forget you in all my life," he said. The next day, the newspaper shouted, "Bill Clinton will never forget the man who lost all his children." The media turned to us to tell the whole world our tale. I work as an assistant executive engineer with the ONGC, that is the Oil and Natural Gas Commission. My wife works with the Life Insurance Corporation as an administrative officer. We were both able to support in the beginning. Yes, we got compensation for the deceased of our children, for the death of our children. 10 lakhs per dead family member from the central government, central and state government. We also got rupees 6 lakh for the death of our children. That was the initial seed capital for us to run the orphanage. Now we are running it smoothly. This orphanage is being run in the memory of three children who died in the tsunami. If they were alive, we would have bequeathed the property to my children, obviously. Now in their death, we have to honor them. We do not have any problem, but we did not get any financial support from both organizations, either ONGC or LIC. But they are not troubling us in this endeavor either. The funding we get from foreign countries is nominal, out of which we take no salary. We are investing our own salary for Nambi Khai. We are not taking any money from the Nambi Khai Trust, because being government officers, we should not take any salary from other sources. So far, we are running the home without any problem. Gradually, a lady from Switzerland started helping. Slowly, other friends started helping. Now, people have started helping us by giving donations. When the orphan children came from fishing villages, it was difficult to get them adjusted to urban life, as they were used to sleeping on sand. Their culture and their day-to-day habits were entirely different from others. The kids suffered culture shock, calling for counseling from us. During counseling, they felt attached to us, looking at us like we were their parents. Then gradually became comfortable with us. Over a period of 10 years, about 10 children were groomed to become good citizens. One boy completed civil engineering and is working in the Gulf. Another boy completed diploma in civil engineering and is working at Chennai. Another boy is completing diploma in marine engineering this year. Another boy is completing diploma in mechanical engineering. Two boys are studying commerce. One boy is studying at Industrial Training Institute. Another girl is doing diploma in information technology. The Parameswarans live in a leafy bungalow, barely a kilometer from the deep blue sea, and had the luxury of the sea froth lulling them to sleep every night. But they had to find peace through tragedy that befell their ideal life. So that is all for tonight. In our next week's video, we will continue with Heroes of the Tsunami. Please do subscribe to our channel and share the videos in your circles and networks, because we need your support and encouragement to start a web series on disaster risk reduction. Please don't forget to tune in to the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. Indian time on Saturday evening, 31st July 2021. I hope to catch you during the live interaction. Until then, take care, keep smiling, stay safe, and stay home. Ciao!